Your Berks Craftsmen on BCTV is supported by the Kutztown Folk Festival and by the Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen. BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
Good evening and welcome to tonight's edition of Your Berks Craftsmen. I am your host, Kay Bennecoff, and tonight we have a juried member of the Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen with us tonight, Jennifer Lehr. Hi, Jen.
Hello, Kay. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm good, good.
Glad to have you here tonight. Thanks for coming into the studio. As you can see, or maybe you don't know what this is in front of us, these are floor cloths, and that's what Jennifer is juried in with the Reading Berks Guild. You became a juried member...
2013, I think. 2013.
2013, okay. So we've had the pleasure of having Jen attend our shows and everything with us, and well, you can find her at other places too, but you know, we're happy to have her at all our shows. Jen started this business about 5 years ago?
It's just... ready to start the sixth year.
Coming
right
into
now.
The sixth
Starting
year.
Starting the sixth year.
Okay. Yep. But we're going to find out how Jen started all of this, you know, how this all happened. Okay. So she's a graduate, 1981, right?
Right.
From Penn State.
Right.
And you were an art major.
Right.
Okay.
I was an art major.
Go ahead. Take it from there.
Well, I Bachelor of Arts in art. And when you do that, you usually pick something that you want to concentrate in. And
okay.
I liked ceramics. Clay, and I liked glass also. So they had a hot glass studio up there at that
okay.
time.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if they have that anymore. So I was blowing glass and making pottery like crazy, and it was really fun. You know, I had a really good time. I also did, you know, you have to take other courses too, like painting and drawing and printmaking, and you have to be kind of diversified.
Sure.
So. I wasn't a fine arts person. If you're fine arts, you concentrate more on one thing.
Oh, okay.
And if you're just a Bachelor of Arts, you're taking all kinds of classes. So.
Okay. So when you were in high school, you were very artsy. Is that, you know? Or
I don't know about that. But yeah. My mother always recognized it. She was the one who said, why don't you take art? You know, I was going to do everything but art.
Uh-huh.
So I said, oh, okay, I like art, you know, so...
Well, you had, so you were definitely had talent going in that
she
direction.
She could see it. I didn't see
and
it.
And you
but
didn't
she
see
could
it.
See it.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, she
yeah.
could.
Okay,
she
that's
was
interesting.
Artsy. She appreciated the art. She didn't do it herself, but she loved the arts.
So she yeah.
Yeah, she liked music and everything.
Oh, okay.
You know,
so you were encouraged highly
yes.
by your
she
mom.
She saw it. She saw it in me. So
yeah, great.
That was good.
Yeah, great influence on your life like that. So she pushed you in that direction, and it was a good thing she
yeah,
did.
Yeah, well,
right?
She suggested it. She put it that way.
Yeah, okay. Gently pushed you then, right? Okay. So that was back in you graduated in 1981, and you did the glass blowing and the pottery for a number of years? Or?
Well, once you get out of college, there's no studio unless
right.
you have a mentor of some kind who can really set you up in business. So.
Uh-huh.
I actually did have a little job at a French restaurant down in Exton. I was the potter, the production potter for all the, it was a high-end restaurant, French. I had to make all the tableware and stuff like that. And that was fun.
Oh, I was going to say.
I really enjoyed that. So anyway, it was time to move on from that. And then, you know, did other things. And finally was in the family business for a lot of years.
Mm-hmm.
And then... kind of had to reinvent myself and went into substitute teaching.
Okay.
In the meantime, I had to homeschool my son.
Yeah, yeah.
So I knew a little bit about the teaching thing, and so I did substituting and happened to be substituting an art class one day, and the book was on the table about these floor cloths, and I had never heard of them before. So I read the book and I was like, oh, that's really interesting. So,
and that was an art teacher you were substituting
yeah,
for an art teacher?
Yeah, it was an art
then.
Class,
okay.
yeah. And anyway, it was pretty neat to see that book there. And it was very odd because I, you know, I kind of put it at the back of my mind. I hadn't been making pottery or glass for 20 years. And then read the book and thought about it, and then they happened to like get rid of the substitutes that year. They told us we all of a sudden had to have education degrees.
Right, you needed an education degree.
So I reinvent myself one more time. So then it was, okay, what are we going to do now? And then my husband came home with two big rolls of canvas he got for free, and it was exactly what I needed from reading the book to make these floor cloths.
Right. So you got the pink slip and the canvas is showed up in your lap, and it's
like
whoa. Voila.
You know, yeah. So just started making them.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, it's been a slow go. You know, people don't know what they are. So that's why I'm glad I'm here.
Right, because that's what we're going to do tonight. We're going to tell them and show them what they are.
People, I find that when I go, especially I just did Kutztown Folk Festival for the last 2 years. The first year, only one out of three people ever heard of them before. So it's not real common. It's not like pottery or, you know, photography or anything like that. It's an odd niche. It's a very odd niche.
Yeah. So we can talk about that a little bit. That it goes back, I mean, what I found and then what you confirmed
right.
when we chatted goes back to the, like the 1400s,
right?
Right.
That's what really interested me when I read that book. The history of it was really interesting. 1400s, 1500s.
Mm-hmm.
It all revolves around sailboats. That's all they had back then. They didn't have any motors or steam or anything wasn't invented yet. So the sailboats are sailing around. And since my parents were both sailors, I knew a little bit about this whole story here. So when you're sailing in a sailboat and your big wind comes and your sail breaks, they call it blows, you blew your sail.
Oh, okay.
If they can't make a smaller sail, because it has ripped in half pretty good, if you can't make a littler sail out of it, it's like, well, I kind of throw it away. So people started painting them and putting them on the floor as cheap man's rugging. They called it poor man's rugging.
Oh, okay.
And it became a whole industry. It was really, really interesting. They had whole factories making these things.
Right. Now, that grew out of that because then, I mean, because we looked at it, started like in France, I guess.
Yeah, right. France where it was all seaside.
Okay.
So France and England, seaside.
Okay.
And if you had money and you could afford a fancy Persian carpet, you know, you don't need a floor cloth. But if you didn't have any money, you get this, you know, less expensive variety. Or if you had, a tile was very expensive, too. If you didn't have tile, you could paint it and make it look like tile.
Mm-hmm. And that's what they did.
Right, right. So it was pretty neat, you know.
Yeah. Okay, so then in the early 1700s, like then the British really got into this, right? And they brought it in, they introduced it to the colonies then.
Right.
I mean, so.
The early colonists, they had to import them from England at first because there was no industry here.
Here, right.
So they didn't travel too well. You know, they were out there on the sea, on the ship, and the rats, and I don't know what happened to them, but it didn't go good, you know.
Right. And I think, and I think especially because of the way they were shipped, you know, and like, didn't they crack and everything, but, you know.
In the early days, they made them out of oil. All they had was oil paint.
Mm-hmm.
And oil paint likes to crack. You know, they know that by every old painting, like Mona Lisa has about a million cracks in her face. So they used old oil paint, and then they had to seal with beeswax in the old days. They just didn't have what we have now. We have more modern materials. But so anyway, they didn't travel good. They were all, you know, damaged by the time they even got here. And then eventually the sign painters took up the trade in the colonies.
Oh, yeah, because they were itinerant artists that would go around in the Rufus
Porter
style, and so those, they tried to do everything to make a living, right?
Right,
you know,
right.
And as they did, so this became prevalent.
That's another reason it's not too well known here in Berks County is because we're not near the sea.
True.
If you go to New England or like the southern states, you know, I've never been to Savannah yet. I need to go there on a little trip. They're like, oh, yeah, in Savannah, if you go on the tours, they have them in all the old mansions and everything.
Yeah.
I'm like, yeah, it was at the sea.
Mm-hmm. But I also read, too, in looking up your craft, you know, mm-hmm. and everything, George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, right. John Adams, and had these, Thomas Jefferson in the White House and everything, and George Washington at Mount Vernon, they did have, mm-hmm. you know, these floor cloths, yeah. okay.
Right.
And most times they were, in the hallways, under the tables.
Right.
You know.
Well, they saved the flooring. That's another big mm-hmm. thing. You know, people are coming in with their muddy boots and everything, right. and the flooring is not cheap, and it still isn't. It's, you know, flooring is high end, mm-hmm. and it helped save the flooring big mm-hmm. time. What was I just going to tell you? Oh, why did they, do you know why they didn't, how they knew that Washington and Jefferson and all those early presidents, they know that they had the floor cloths because you got taxed on your valuables back then.
Mm-hmm.
And they had to have inventory of their valuables, and floor cloths were valuable to them. They were listed there, so they know that they had them. That's how we know.
Yeah, they were. And they were kind of pricey for the day.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, back in the day, they weren't cheap, you know, but a lot goes into it, as we'll later
talk
about. You'll understand why, you know, because of the process. That's why they're so durable, though.
Right.
You know, I mean, you know, when we go through, you mm-hmm. know, I mean, really how much work goes into one of these.
Yeah,
you know?
It's not, it looks easy, but it's not.
Yeah. And one more thing before we go on here a little bit, oil cloths, they're
right.
called by so many different
right.
names, floor cloths, oil cloths. That was because, how did they get the name oil cloth?
Well, I don't know. There's a lot of stories out there. Well, from what I can figure out here is, I'm thinking the first ones were, I said all they had was oil paint.
Mm-hmm.
So they painted them with oil, so mm-hmm. I figure they called them oil cloths.
Mm-hmm.
And then eventually things changed.
Mm-hmm. And they used a lot of linseed oil?
Well, in 1860,
okay.
this is a whole other story.
Okay.
I don't know if we want to talk about that one yet.
Oh, sure we do.
They called them oil cloths then, too.
Okay.
So anyway, the hand-painted version was going along smoothly, and then there was a fellow in 1860 who happened to, he was trying to make glue.
Oh, okay.
This is the guy who was trying to invent
okay.
glue or make a new kind of glue. And he took linseed oil and he took sawdust and he took a couple other things. I never got the details on that. But there was a chemical reaction in the can. He mixed them all together and it started foaming up and it, over the edge and all over
all
his
over
table,
it.
Over his workbench.
Goo.
Yeah, and since he was making glue, it was a sticky mess.
Yeah.
So he went back inside, and he came back out hours later, and it had hardened, but it was pliable. And that's how linoleum got invented.
Oh.
With a base of linseed oil.
Linoleum.
Linoleum, he called it.
Okay. So then that kind of overtook,
right.
You know.
So now linoleum was invented, and they could mass produce linoleum, which
uh-huh.
was similar to a floor cloth.
Mm-hmm.
It was almost the same thing. But the hand-painted, one-of-a-kind version went out the window.
Okay,
it
so because
obsolete
then
now.
Okay, right. Because and it was probably faster to make this.
Oh yeah.
Linoleum at this
right,
point.
Linoleum.
You know? And it was softer to touch. You know, it kind of gave a
right.
a
it
softer.
Was, it
rock.
Was really durable. That's for sure. Some people say it's still in some houses. You know, the
oh,
old
linoleum.
Stuff.
Oh yeah. Yeah, I would think so. I think lead got in some of that, though,
yeah, I don't
so
know.
It's not as...
Yeah, I don't know what they made it out of. I'm sure lead was involved.
Yeah, I think I read that, you know.
So we're lead-free now. Everything's safe.
Yes, yes. Yeah, we're not going there, so, you know. But here again, you paint with acrylic paint?
Yeah, everything I use is water-based.
Water-based, okay. Not acrylic, I shouldn't have said that.
Well, yeah.
Oh, is it acrylic? Okay.
Acrylic means the paint has plastic in it.
Right, okay.
Everything water-based, the paints have really evolved. They're really sophisticated now. I mean, you can, now they have paints when you paint your wall inside. It's the primer and the paints in one
mm-hmm.
coat.
Yeah.
They didn't have that even a couple years ago.
No.
So paint has really evolved a lot.
Yeah.
So even 10 years ago, they were sealing them with polyurethane, and now we have a water-based polyurethane. So the other polyurethane was oil-based. Okay. So the oil and the water don't like each other, and they fight each other, and they crack. That's where you get cracking.
Okay.
So if you stay, you either have to stay with one or the other.
Mm-hmm. Like the whole process, I mean, you know, so that you're not...
Right. I'm all water-based. Okay. I get dizzy on the oil-based. I feel like... bad,
yeah.
You know?
But you can get the same effect, you know, with using this. I mean, you know.
The thing about water-based paint is it dries quicker, and you can't get a lot of the shading that you can with oil.
With oil.
You can work oil a lot longer to get more desirable effects. This just dries real fast. You've got to work fast.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So that's the main difference as far as when you're constructing this. It doesn't really change the process if you'd be using oils versus water-based paint.
No, I just like the water-based. I think it's safer. I think it's better for the environment, too.
I think so,
The
too.
Fumes don't get to me.
Right.
The main thing that.
And so that would, you know, unless you're a total purist that you would have to, you know.
I don't know if anybody works with oil. They could. I don't know.
Yeah. In reproduction work, you know, I mean, you know, like some of the people that you told me to look up.
Right.
I mean, that were doing some, like, maybe really totally reproductions, and they probably work in oils maybe, but
I don't know. I never asked them.
No.
They were helpful, though. There's some people on the internet that I had a question about seaming one. I had a big long hallway I was doing. It was 24 feet, and mm-hmm. I needed to throw a seam in there, and I called up one of these people that are really good, and uh-huh. they helped me. I was like, thank you, you know, because I had an idea what to do, but I wasn't sure. So,
well, that's how craftsmen are, though.
Yeah,
you
it was
know?
Really
I
nice.
Mean, you know, that's what we like to do at Reading Berks. You know, we like to share the knowledge that we have of our craft, pass that on to the customers, you know, and it makes the product more endearing to the to the customer as well. So no matter, even if they're not a member of Reading Berks, they still share their you know, help you out with things like that, you know, as far.
Nice.
Yeah, in fact, if any of you have a question for Jen tonight, you can call in here at 610-378-0426. Jen will be happy to answer your questions on the history and product making of floorcloths. So, where shall we go from here, Jen? Should we start with what you have here and tell us how you do it, or should we start with the process, actually, from the beginning of it?
Maybe the process first.
Okay. And it is quite extensive.
Yeah, it's like, it looks like you just paint some canvas and you're done.
Yeah, not
it
exactly.
It doesn't really work that way. I start out with a real heavy canvas. It's not something you just get it down at the fabric store. This is like heavy super duty stuff, and it comes in different numbers of heaviness. So I usually generally number 8, and if I'm going to the big sizes, I move up to number 4.
Okay, and that's for the thickness?
Yeah, the thickness.
I mean, okay.
The bigger rugs need a bigger...
I was going to say.
A more, you know...
Substantial.
More guts to the canvas.
Yeah. And where do you find something like this?
I just get it on the internet.
Oh,
but
okay.
I buy in bulk. I buy like 50 yards at a whack.
Oh, okay.
So, yeah, so...
So when the truck rolls in, it's pretty big.
Yeah, and you can... The biggest width you can get in canvas is 10 feet.
Okay.
So I have a roll of that. That came on a big truck.
Yeah.
My husband didn't like it too much when he had to move it.
I'm sure.
Yeah, I put it on a dolly and everything. It's really heavy.
Oh,
it's like 300 pounds
oh, I
you're
was
talking
gonna
about
say,
here.
Yeah.
It's a big roll. And then you can get a half a roll like at 5 feet.
Okay, so you buy it in different widths. So
right. I think you can get 5 feet and 4 feet,
mm-hmm.
but... If they start out with 10, 5 feet makes sense to cut that in
sure,
half. You know?
Sure.
So anyway, so I get the canvas and then I cut it, but you have to think about shrinkage. That's the next problem you have.
Oh.
It shrinks. You have to shrink the canvas. Kind of like when you do an oil painting, you have canvas and you stretch it on a frame, and then you they don't usually shrink with water, but they apply gesso. And it draws, shrinks the canvas. What I do is I apply water at first. And
just plain water?
Yeah, just plain water. And it draws the canvas tight, kind of.
Oh,
it shrinks it. So you can lose inches. So you have to, like, kind of have a formula, maybe, if you're lucky, because you never know what it's going to do. Mm-hmm. It might, on a big piece, you could lose, I figure I lose about an inch every foot on the length.
Oh, wow. Oh, okay.
The width doesn't seem to shrink as much as the length for some reason. I don't know why. But okay. So you kind of have to think ahead. So you shrink it, you cut it, you shrink it, then you have to start priming it. You might have to iron it a couple times because you don't want any creases. You have to kind of be careful about handling it, because if you flip it the wrong way, you might get like a crease, and they're really hard to get out.
Oh, okay.
So, you know, then you're there with a steam iron.
I was
going to
say, just a regular steam iron.
You know, you're just hoping it comes out.
Yeah.
So anyway, after you do that, you have to prime it with a primer.
And that
is? It's like a sealer. I use gesso.
Gesso. Okay, you had mentioned that.
Other people use different things. You know, I don't know. I use gesso, and I use the good stuff, because one time I used the cheap stuff. I'll put it that way.
Okay.
The cheap stuff. And I got cracking in my final product. So I figure I better use the good stuff. So.
Well, what constitutes... Do you know what the difference is? What constitutes
I don't know what the formulas are.
Oh, okay.
I have no idea.
I didn't know if you compared ingredients, you know, to find out what was...
I go by price, I guess. I don't know. The good stuff costs more.
The good stuff costs more.
I don't know what's in it.
Yeah.
I know historically gesso has glue in it, but I don't know if it does now or not. I don't know what
I would almost think so.
What the formulas.
I mean, you know. Yeah.
So anyway, then I would sand it.
Sand it with sandpaper?
Yeah, sandpaper.
Oh, okay. A then certain grit? I mean, do you know?
Like 180, something like that, 180. Then I will prime it again.
Another
and
coat
I'll
of
sand
gesso.
It again.
And another
then I
sanding.
Usually prime it three times and sand it three times. And then I start with base coats. Like this one right here. This rug has like a light colored base coat, so two or three coats of that, and then I think I went in here. I like to make them have a little contrast, so I'll go in here and do some like faux ragging or whatever. It's to try to not make it look so flat. And then...
Well, first, I think we need to step back and
how many
say
steps
what...
Was this?
Oh, we're way up there.
we're cutting, sanding, prime, sand, prime... Right. Cutting, shrinking... Prime sand, prime sand, prime sand, base. So we're at 10, base.
Yeah.
Okay, now we're at faux. I don't, that one doesn't have any faux.
Mm-hmm.
Neither one of these. It just kind of, you just kind of go in there with, be creative.
Okay, so you did say ragging. Well, see, not all our viewers
there's
out
different
there.
There's ways to do
yeah.
it.
Yeah, so do you literally take a rag then?
Oh, yeah.
You know?
Sometimes
okay.
sponging. There's
sponging?
All kinds of techniques for faux painting. You know, ragging mm-hmm. off, all kinds of stuff.
So it doesn't give it texture, but it looks almost
yeah,
like
it gives you a depth. Yeah,
yes,
you can see
you know,
it.
Shadowing or, you know.
I always figure it hides the crumbs in the food.
There you go.
A little...
That hasn't happened yet, but.
Yeah.
But it will.
I'm sloppy at my house. But anyway, so then I get the background, and then I make a stencil. This is a folky one here. This is going to Kutztown Folk Festival for sure. Make a stencil or whatever. This one here, I was more of a free design, free painting.
Oh, you did. Oh, okay. You free painted on here.
And this one also, this floral over here, that's just free painting. So then we get a design, and then we... I taped this off and did this whole edging thing.
I was going to say, there's a lot of taping involved.
Yeah. So this, first I did this part.
You did
and
this
then,
part.
Then I taped this off, and now I'm working on this. And this is called combing. This is an old, the Pennsylvania Germans loved combing.
Okay, yeah, let's kind of...
Yeah, they would
just show this here. This is the part where you're saying is called
this
the
one over
combing.
Here has combing.
Oh, that
too.
Has combing as well on the border.
Right.
You would call that the border, right?
Right.
Okay. And so explain combing. Okay.
The Pennsylvania Germans loved combing. Oh. They did it to a lot of their furniture.
Mm-hmm.
It's just neat. I don't know. It was their style.
And
this German thing comes out of me every now and then, because I grew up in Ole, so
okay.
That might be a problem, you know, one of the reasons.
Why you have a lot of German
well,
content.
A lot of history.
A lot of history.
Going through our house.
I'm sure.
But anyway, So then this one, I did the combing thing, and then...
And so, literally, it is a comb.
Yeah, you put on a
almost
paint.
Like what people wore in their hair.
Well, it could be. It could be any kind of comb. I have a rubber one. But
okay.
You could make any kind. You could get an old rake or anything you wanted to try to do. But in the old, they would take a feather. You know, there's different ways to do this faux stuff. So anyway, after I'm done with the design, I start sealing. So it's usually about 5 coats of sealer I put on here. And each coat, in between all this stuff, each coat has to dry. So it's a lot of time.
Right. Now, the sealer is different, of course, from the gesso because that...
Yeah, that's
building.
Clear.
Yeah.
The sealer's clear.
The sealer's clear.
So that's when I'm up there with my mask. And
okay.
Because I don't, you know.
Now, is that brushed on or stated, or do you spray
it on? I roll it on.
Okay.
My son says I should spray it on, but I'm not ready for that yet. So.
Okay.
So anyway, I roll it on in 5 coats. You know, that takes about at least a couple days. It usually takes me about 3 weeks to do a series. I usually...